wonderful treat for the end of the year to see you, dear. I'm Pastor Richard Allen Farmer, and welcome to this last day of the year. We made it. We made it. A lot of people began the year, went home to be with the Lord, or to their other eternal home before the year ended. But here we are on the 52nd Sunday of the year, the 365th day of the year, and we are grateful to have come this far. I have just a couple of announcements, and then Bill Small will come and emphasize a couple of others. This evening at 6 p.m., we will have a joint service with our brothers and sisters from the Trinity Presbyterian Church, formerly of Decatur. They have now moved into the Pine Lake area, and they will be our guests this evening at 6 o'clock for a New Year's Eve service. And you know, it is rude to invite guests to your home and you not be here to receive said guests. So would you please come out in good number this evening at 6 and welcome our friends. Both I and the pastor of the Trinity Church will preach 15-minute sermons tonight. So there will be two sermons and singing and remembering those who have left us this year or in past years. So do come out and enjoy that service. And my second announcement is that we will have a baptismal service next Sunday morning at 8:15 at the Fairfield Baptist Church. We have three candidates from this church, and we're going to be simply piggybacking on their already scheduled baptismal service. And we are baptizing three from here. I wonder if they are here. I don't see Asia Lewis yet, but Regine Huddleston is here, and she's going to be baptized next week. Would you just stand, honey, so they can see you? Just stand. That's Regine and her mother. Where's your mom? She's in the nursery. All right, wonderful. And then Asia Lewis is our third person. excuse me. This is the last day you may give an offering directed to the Crossroads Presbyterian Church, and it be counted as charitable giving for 2023. Please do not bring an offering next week and ask our finance people to date it for having been given in 2023. That is dishonest, and we don't do that. Thank you, both of you, who affirm that. But this is the last day for giving to be counted for a charitable gift year 2023. You may either give this morning or this evening, but this is the last day. Bill Small.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Whoa. So take out your heart lines and follow along with me if you would. Most of the announcements are just reminders of those that we have had before. Remember, next Sunday, there's a reception for the pastor after the service. And there is information about how we can help with that in terms of food and contact information for Beryl Lindsay and the hospitality ministry. So please, let's all pitch in and help with that. There are really a couple of announcements for the Stone Moton Food Pantry. There is information about how to sign up and help with that, since January is our month to help physically, to be on site here from Crossroads, so please be aware of that. The announcement that we had last Sunday is not in the Heartlines this week, but also if you can help transport food from here to the pantry, you might get in touch with the church office if you can help with that process. And please be aware of the fact that the second pantry, the one that we have out in the parking lot to help homeless people that are in this region, has been really low. The last time I looked at it, it was empty. So please bring food to help locally with packaging that facilitates being able to open it on site, maybe a pop-top lid or something like that, and contribute. There's a place there in the narthex in terms of where you can deposit that kind of material for food. Pastor's already announced the service tonight. There are a couple of other dates. January 4th, this Thursday, there is a Bible study for Ezekiel, chapters 12 and 13, at 7 p.m. And if you need information about the Zoom, you can get that from the church office. Zumba begins Saturday the 6th. There is, because of the service tonight, the need for seats. So let's leave the chairs down for the service tonight and not pick them up. Please remember to pass the attendance rolls from the outer to the inner seats during the offering time. And please make note of the fact that in your bulletin there is a flyer that talks about the 2024 per capita fee. There's information about what those funds are used for and how to make that contribution. So please be aware of that and educate yourself if that's something that we need to think about for this time of year. And with that in mind, I'm going to ask you to stand as we have our call to worship, as we prepare to worship together. It's a responsive reading. Arise, shine, for the light of the world has come. Darkness covers the earth and its people, but the radiance of God's light burns away its shadows, illuminates the smallest corner, and heralds in the starred of a new dawn. Here we are, Lord. Illumine us, purify us, and shine through us as we worship, listen, and respond to you this holy hour. Please stay standing for our opening hymn.
Christians all rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Listen now to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Ox and ass before him now, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. Good Christians all rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Hear the news of endless bliss. Jesus Christ was born for this. He has opened heaven's door, and we are blessed forevermore. Christ is born for this. Christ is born for this. Good Christians all rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now you need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to save. Come at his most gracious call to find salvation one and all. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save.
Our prayer of confession is a chance for us to be honest and to prepare our hearts to worship with integrity. So let's pray together. Let's make sure that these words come from our heart. And then notice at the end, there's a chance for us to have kind of a response together in song. So let's pray together. Father God, sometimes we forget that the Christmas story did not end in the stable, but continued as Jesus grew into a man, almost unnoticed by the world, apart from his appearance at the temple, his spiritual home on earth. As we close the pages of one year and begin the next chapter of our lives, may we grow in faith, in wisdom, and closer to you each day, to your praise and glory. Amen.
Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born. today.
And hear the good news, the assurance of pardon. The scriptures promise that God will make all things new. As God makes the year new for us, may we also be made new by God's love and his forgiveness in Jesus. And we all say it.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. Let us remember the little town of Bethlehem.
Testify, say, Jesus brought me out all right. I said, Jesus brought me out all right. He brought me out of darkness into his marvelous light. Oh, Jesus brought me out all right. I guarantee today that he will bring you out
all right.
He will bring you out all right. Yes, he will. He will bring you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Oh, Jesus brought me out all right. Let him bring you out all right.
All right.
Let him bring you out all right.
All right.
Let him bring you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Let him bring you out.
All right.
Now look at somebody and sing it to him. Let him bring you out all right.
Bring
Look at somebody. Look at your neighbor and say, let him bring you out all right. If you let him, he will bring you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Oh, let him bring you out all right. Let him bring you out of darkness. Bring you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Oh, let him bring you out. Oh,
you may be seated. In our prayers, let us, in addition to remembering these who are listed in the heart lines, let us remember those for whom this is a very gloomy and dark time. This holiday season, they have perhaps lost a loved one during the year. Perhaps this is the anniversary of the loss of a loved one, but the Christmas season is a very depressing season for some. And in addition to our remembering these, let us remember those. I made my final weekly visit to Uvalin Patterson this past week. It was bittersweet. I usually, unless I'm traveling, I was visiting her every week. And I said to her daughter, this is my last visit. I'll be retiring and moving. And it was an emotional time for me. My administrative aide, our administrative assistant, said to me, I don't like all these last things you're doing these months. Last Lenten season, last this and that. I don't like all these lasts. But it is what it is. Let us pray for those who are closing down periods of their lives. I'd like to include myself in that group. Let us pray for those who are looking at new seasons in their lives as we go to prayer today. I want to give you some moments to pray in your own voice, taking to God your own concerns and praises, and then it will be my joy to lead you in prayer. Let us pray. Papa, we come to you as your children and thank you that you have bid us come, that you have welcomed us into your presence by and through Jesus. We who on our own would have no right to come before thee. We thank you for Jesus the Christ, mediator, intercessor. We thank you for his opening up the way so that we may call ourselves the children of God. We hear your word. He went to his own, and his own did not receive him. But as many as did receive him, to them he gave the right to call themselves the children of God. So here we are. Papa, your children, coming before you with boldness rather than fear, because you have bid us come. Before we would ask thee for anything, before we would petition thee, we praise thee. Before we ask for a thing, we want to say thank you. It's been a rough year for some, but we thank you that we're still here. It's been a difficult few months for some, but we thank you we made it to December. We praise you for life and health and strength just to be able to show up today is a blessing, and we want to say thank you. We thank you for the transportation that got us here. We thank you for the resources to put gas in our cars or to charge our batteries. We want to thank you for physical strength. Thank you for clothing to put on. Thank you that many of us ate a breakfast this morning. There are many around the world that will not eat today. We say thank you. We thank you for each other, for this embodiment of the body of Christ, for the faith community, for the church of which we are a part. We say thank you that we're not in pursuit of you by ourselves. Thank you for colleagues, for brothers and sisters and mothers and fathers in the faith who encourage us in our own pursuit of godliness. We say thank you. Now you have given us permission to not only bring to you our praises, but our petitions, our wants, our desires. We bring before you these listed in the heartlines who need your touch on their bodies. We pray for them and for their families, for Larry Steele and Angela Cottrell, and Brenda Dolson and Michael Hairston, and Lanice Fryer, for Darlene Mueller and Isaac Wood, Anne Marie Tillman and Lisa Lauer. We pray your touch upon them. For Anna Clark and Eason Simon, for Jewel Walker and Nikki Smith, we pray. For John Gregory and Rosa Crowley and Edward and Evelyn Patterson, we pray. We intercede for Jarvis Hall and Henry Stevens. We would stand with these who are doing grief work during this season of celebration, for Lilith Hunt and Tasia Hunt and their extended family in the death of their brother and uncle in Jamaica. For Devante and Amani Rucker and their family in the death of his grandfather. For Pamela Grudois and her extended family in the homegoing of her auntie. For David Ugbaja and the passing of his brother in Nigeria. We would pray for our partners in ministry, for Tony and Veronica Warner and Annette Smith and Focus Community Strategies, and Gary Lane and Jacqueline Huggins and the Goss Giffrods, and Margaret Garner and Richard and Amanda Coleman. We would pray for our nation. We would pray for our city. We'd pray for our county. There is so much going on that breaks our hearts. Violence in our streets, wayward youth. People who desperately need Jesus. We would name in our hearts right now people we know who need to be saved. We pray for the lost, for those without a personal relationship with Jesus. Pray that you would use us to spread the good news. Christ has come. He's come for us to seek and to save that which is lost. Oh, Papa, open our mouths when we have too long been silent. Give to us a burden, a concern for the lost. We pray for our neighborhood. Pray that you continue to use us as a light on this corner, at this crossroads. May we be sensitive to the broken, the wounded, the disenfranchised, and may Jesus shine through us, we pray. We ask this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Now I think we're supposed to have an update from the interim pastor nominating committee.
Hello, Crossroads family. My name is Glenda Collins, and I'm a member of the Interim Pastor Nominating Committee, and I'm here to provide a status for today. So far, we received 6 candidates from Cassandra Morrow, our congregational consultant. We have reviewed 4, and we've chosen 1 to interview so far. We have 2 more candidates to review. We plan to do our interview process after January 5th, 2024. Our next committee update for you all will be Sunday, January 7th, 2024. Please continue to pray for us. This is not an easy task. Thank you.
Thank you, Glenda. If you are a first-time visitor, or if you are not a first-time visitor, but a dear friend from Dallas, Texas, you please stand, will you? If you're first-time visitors or beloved guests from Dallas, Texas, would you please stand? Please remain standing until you've received both a visitor's card and a microphone. We'd like to hear where you're from, your name, and then you may be seated. Yes, sir.
Melise, I am from Atlanta, Georgia.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Thank you for being with us today. You may be seated after you've spoken. Yes, sir.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Reverend Oga Otumala. I'm based here in Atlanta, Global Missionary, a friend of Annette Smith.
Yes.
And an alumni of Carver University.
Yes, she told me you were coming today. Bless you, brother. You may be seated.
My name is Larry Mercer, and my wife, Annie Mercer. We're from Dallas, Texas. We love your pastor. We could not miss this day. We're glad to be here today.
We're the Charles family from Austin, Texas.
Yes, you are.
Grace Mercer from Dallas, Texas.
Dallas, Texas. Thank you very much. Mrs. Mercer and I share a birthday, and there are very few November 16s that go by where we don't touch base with each other and express our great affection for each other on the phone. It is good to see you, Mercer clan. What a great, great joy. I was to make this announcement earlier, and I apologize. There are some resources on the table. I'm cleaning out my office, and there are pounds of books that I do not wish to transport to Dallas. So there are some resources out on that table, free for the taking. If you are visiting us in the digital sanctuary, thank you for being with us today. Would you please send an email simply saying that you were with us today for the first time? You'll send that email to office@crossroads-pc.com. That's office@crossroads-pc.com. If you put in the subject line, "was with you for the first time today," we'd be delighted to respond, and we are happy that you have come to be with us. Well, it is giving time. That was just pitiful. All right. I am celebrating the joy of giving. I use envelopes. I'm old school. I like to watch the box of envelopes go down as I give every week. And this past week on Thursday, I threw the box away because I had used up all the envelopes, the last of which are here this morning. What a joy to give consistently to the Lord's work. And I want to urge you to join me, not in tipping God. Some of you have come to the 31st of December and have discovered that you have given over the last 12 months $300 to the Lord's work. You ought to be embarrassed. You ought to be ashamed. As good as God has been to us, we ought to give him the first fruits of our income. He has allowed us to generate income. Amen. Amen. Every time I pay a bill, I think, yes, but I have it. I'm able to pay the bill. Every time I go to Publix, you know, they don't want to hear your testimony at the cashier. They want money. God has been good, hallelujah. No, they want money. They don't want you to give them a tract. They don't want to hear about how God has been good to you. They want money. And every time I go to the cashier, I'm rejoicing. I have it. I'm able to actually buy these groceries. I hope you will honor the Lord for all that he has done, all that he has given, and be consistent about it. Treat it like a bill. You owe God his tithe, and you ought to pay it with joy. You owe God his offering, and you ought to give that offering with great, great joy. I'm a hilarious giver. Join me, will you? With offering in hand, if you're giving an offering this morning, you may bring it forward. Perhaps you've given online. Perhaps you've given by bringing a check by the building this week. But with offering in hand or anything in your hand that represents your stewardship. Let us stand if you're able, and let us pray together. God the giver, we thank you for these resources you have entrusted to us. As we give, we do so with grateful hearts. With cheerfulness, we return a portion of your gifts, that Crossroads Church may care for the financially distressed, spread the gospel to the nations, address economic and political injustices, create and sustain ministries that develop disciples of Jesus the Christ. As we give, we pray that you, Holy God, will teach us how to give. May our motives be pure, our hearts be glad, and our hands be open. We pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated.
Father, we do ask you to receive our praise and to receive these tithes and these offerings and our lives that go with them. We pray it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
And now we have a children's choir that's coming to sing. And as they're coming, yeah. As they're coming, I've been asked to make an additional announcement. Next Sunday, the first Sunday of the year, the request is that we wear white. So we may have to wear sunglasses as well, because it may get pretty bright. But wear white as we celebrate bringing in a new year together. Amen. So I think it's very appropriate that children ages 4 and 5 and up through grades 4 and 5 go have a blast.
I see Austin Cottrell home for Christmas. Great to see you, sir. Do we have any other college students who are home for Christmas that I've overlooked? Anybody else back home for the holidays? Well, Kia, yes. Thank you, Kia. Good to see you. Good to see you. I'm not sure you really qualify as a college student home for Christmas. As I recall, you have graduated from college. Thank you. But thank you, Mother, for suggesting she's really not in that number. Yes, thank you. It's great to see you all. I want to read a passage from the book of Acts and then share with you a few thoughts from it. If you're able, would you please stand as we honor the word of God. Acts chapter 20, beginning at verse 25. This is one of the most emotional passages in the entire New Testament, in my opinion. And I'll ask you to keep the text open on your lap or accessed on your smart device, because during the sermon I'm going to point you to some verses. But let's begin by, for now, just reading verses 25 through 32 from the New King James Version of the Scriptures, Acts chapter 20. Paul is speaking. "And indeed, now I know that you all, among whom I've gone preaching the kingdom of God, will see my face no more. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I am innocent of the blood of all people. For I have not shunned to declare to you the whole counsel of God. Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourselves, people will rise up, speaking perverse things, to draw away the disciples after themselves. Therefore, watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. So now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. You may be seated. You're not home from college either, but is that Sarah Walker?
Yes.
Hello, beloved Sarah. Good to see you. Now, holy God, we ask you to shed light upon our sometimes darkened minds. Speak, O Lord, and may your servants hear you and receive your word with gladness. Amen.
Amen.
I've been preaching for over half a century now, and I have always tried to find myself inside a text that I'm preaching. This was easier than most. I can locate myself in this text. Clearly, Paul and the elders of the church at Ephesus loved each other. You have only to read this passage and to read Ephesians chapter 3 to see how much Paul loved the Ephesians. This text is full of deep emotion as Paul reminisces about his time among the Ephesians. His time has been positive. I want to relate this passage to my time among you. Paul will say, and so will I, during our time together, there have been no scandals, no church splits, no withholding of helpful information, no sugarcoating of the gospel, no lack of transparency. Paul says, I shared myself with you for the time I have been with you, and for these past 10 years, I have shared myself with you. Paul is fully aware, as am I, that the details of his future are unclear to him. He has an idea of where he's headed, but in his words, chains and tribulations await him. You see that in verse 22. And see, now I go bound in the Spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies in every city, saying that chains and tribulations await me. That's enough to make you stop and just work on that. Let me try to get ready for these trials and chains and tribulations. But Paul says, but that's not my greatest concern. I would think that would be your greatest concern. I would think that would be your priority. If you know that up ahead of you are chains and tribulations, let's work on that. Let's see if we can even avoid that. But Paul, I greatly admire him here, says that the fact that chains and tribulations await me is less important than my having a strong finish among you. That's so admirable. He could be working on this stuff that he knows is ahead of him. He'd rather work on making sure that he has a good, strong finish with the Ephesians. Look at verse 24. But none of these things move me. He's just talked about chains and tribulations. He said, but that's not important now. None of these things occupy my headspace. Nor do I count my life dear to myself. He said, I don't want to spend a lot of time working on my issues regarding the future, the chains and tribulations. He says, so that I may finish my race with joy and the ministry which I received from the Lord Jesus. Do you hear it? What is most important to me is that I honor the Lord and that I finish strongly with the ministry God gave me. You hear it? He's more concerned about the Ephesians' spiritual health than he is about his upcoming chains and tribulations. Boy, that's good. And then after that testimony, Paul issues a warning. I have located myself in this text as Paul, and I want to issue the same warning to you, my beloved Crossroads family, that Paul issued to his beloved Ephesian colleagues. The warning is in two parts. Number one, after my departure, there will be outsiders who will infiltrate either by physical presence or rhetoric and try to stir up a bunch of mess right up in here, up in here. And the agenda of these external people is purely evil and unbiblical, and you should be on your guard. That's what Paul says to these folks. I want you to see it in the text. This is not my idea. This is not Farmer had a bunch of things he wanted to get off his chest. I want to work the text. It's right here in the text. Therefore, verse 28, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock. Now let's skip down to verse 29. For I know this, after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you. That is, they are outside people. But after I leave, they're going to come in, they're going to feel free to infiltrate and come in among you and stir up a bunch of mess. In 1781, a British pastor named George Heath published a great hymn. I grew up singing this hymn, but I don't hear it much these days. But the hymn is called, My Soul, Be on Thy Guard. Listen to the text. My soul, be on thy guard. 10,000 foes arise. The hosts of sin are pressing hard to draw thee from the skies. Oh, watch and fight and pray. The battle ne'er give o'er. Renew it boldly every day and help divine implore. Ne'er think the victory won, nor once at ease sit down. The arduous work will not be done till thou hast got the crown. Fight on, my soul, till death shall bring thee to my God. He'll take thee at thy parting breath to his divine abode. Crossroads, be on your guard. Watch for these outsiders, either physical presence or voices, influences, influencers, who want to wreak havoc in this faith community. And this is a warning that Paul issued often in various ways. 1 Timothy chapter 3, Paul warns his spiritual son Timothy that in the last days people will act up and be described by several negative nouns and adjectives. Listen to him. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, and people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemous, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people, turn away. Do you hear it? Paul says, after I leave, the folks are going to come in here and they've got no proper biblical agenda. They just want to stir up stuff. They love themselves more than they love God. They don't love you. They just want to create some mess. Be on your guard, he says. Watch for them. Be careful. Be careful who you just let come in. Galatians chapter 2. Verses 3 to 5. Yet not even Titus, who was with me, was compelled to be circumcised, even though he was a Greek. This matter arose because, listen to this, some false believers had infiltrated our ranks to spy on the freedom we have in Christ Jesus. And they wanted to make us slaves. Wow. Paul says, we did not give in to them for a moment. Beware, Crossroads family, of outsiders who will infiltrate your ranks and spread discord and dissension and heresy, and address them boldly in the name of Jesus. And they're coming for you. They're going to wait till I leave. But after my departure, savage wolves will come in. That's the first part of the warning. There will be externals. Here's the second part of Paul's warning. Again, I don't want you to think this is pharma. I'm just working the text. Verse 30, he talks about these savage wolves who will come in verse 29 after his departure. And perhaps worse, verse 30, and from among yourselves, people will rise up, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. Paul said there is a great possibility that there will be external forces coming in. But worse, there will be internal wolves who will try to stir up some stuff. Be on your guard. There'll be some who think, we don't have a pastor now. We don't even have the interim now. We can do whatever we want. And it will be couched in language that sounds so reasonable. But I want you to be on your guard. There'll be people right from this congregation who will begin a sentence like this. We don't have a pastor now. I was just thinking maybe we could. And then they'll say something so bizarre, so out there. But they will expect you as session or deacons or leaders, they'll expect you to just buy it. Since we don't have a pastor, I was just wondering if we could. We got all this land here. Why don't we plant cannabis and then sell it? And we don't have a pastor. I was just wondering if, wouldn't that be a good idea? That'd be a good way for the church to generate some money. This would be somebody right here. When Dr. Farmer was here, I wanted to so-and-so, but now that he's not here, I was wondering if maybe we could. Don't you think that's a good idea? They'll come to you, some of you leaders. They'll say, during this interim time, I was wondering if we could. I know this is really out there, but I was wondering if we could, or what do you think about this? these are not, Paul says in his warning, people from out there. These are people, in his language, from among yourselves. Sometimes I would look at the behavior of my siblings and I would think to myself, but we're from the same litter. Where's this coming from? Right from among ourselves, there's discord. We're not talking about somebody outside the family, we're talking about somebody right inside, stirring up a bunch of mess. And Paul says, I love you, Ephesians. Be on your guard for forces both external and internal that could wreak havoc in this relatively healthy community of faith. And Paul leaves these beloved Ephesians with two simple yet powerful verbs: watch and remember. Watch and remember. Again, not my idea. Farmer's trying to push some agenda before he goes. I'm just working the text. Verse 31, therefore, that is in light of all that I've said, watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone night and day with tears. Paul says, my end is near. Now watch and remember. I leave you with the same two verbs. Watch. Be on your guard. This is not a time to get spiritually lax. Be vigilant. Be listening. Have your antennae up. What's happening? What is being said? What is God saying? Remember, he says. Watch and remember. Remember the teachings of Jesus. One of the roles of the Holy Spirit in our lives, according to John chapter 14, verse 26, is that the Holy Spirit, well, let me read the verse. John 14, 26, Jesus is speaking, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things I said to you. You hear it? When the Holy Spirit comes, one of his roles will be that he will remind you of what you've been taught. I urge you to remember the teachings of Jesus. What did Jesus say about that matter? I know four young men who are the four sons of one of my closest friends in Dallas who's gone to be with the Lord. She was a stickler for good grammar, as am I, and we would swap stories of how the English language had been murdered by some users. We'd swap stories. She told me that her sons, whenever they came upon a grammatical problem, they weren't sure if they should say I or me, they'd say, how would mom say it? And they said they were always correct if they remembered their mother and how she would say it. Is it I or me? Thank you for your kindness to my wife and I. No, that's not right. Thank you for your kindness to my wife and me. Yeah, that's how mom would say it. Okay, got it. You know, Paul says to the Ephesians, remember. Remember my words among you. Remember the words of Jesus. Watch and remember. I'm going to ask you to remember what Jesus said. And in what sounds like a narcissistic moment, remember what I've taught you over 10 years. Remember how we have been more eager to hear the scriptures than to hear some motivational concepts. I've never stood and said, let me give you 7 ways to have a prosperous life. And I give you some stuff that has nothing to do with the Bible. Remember what we have pursued together. Remember the words of Jesus. Remember the words of your pastor. Remember what Jesus has taught you, what he's poured into you. And if you can't remember, ask the Holy Spirit whose role it is, according to John 14:26, to bring to your remembrance what Jesus said. And then after Paul issues this 2-word warning, he commends his colleagues to God. Oh. Again, I don't want you to think these are my ideas. Verse 32, so now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. And now, brethren, sistren, I commend you to God. This farewell, this commending of the saints of God also appears in another form in Acts chapter 14, verse 23. You read it later. I commit you into the hands of God. Good hands. You remember that commercial? You're in good hands with Allstate. Yeah. You all knew that. You're in good hands if I commend you and commit you into the hands of God. You're in great hands. John Fawcett was a British Baptist pastor about whom I read quite a bit this week. He was sent to a rural congregation in Wainsgate, England. It was a small, backwards kind of congregation. It wasn't a prestigious pulpit to which Fawcett was called at all. Hymnologist Albert Barnes described the congregation at Wainsgate, to which John Fawcett was sent. Barnes writes, the people were all farmers and shepherds, poor as Job's turkey, an uncouth lot whose speech one could hardly understand, unable to read or write, most of them pagans, cursed with vice and ignorance and wild tempers. The established church had never touched them. Only the humble Baptist had sent an itinerant preacher there, and he'd made a good beginning. That's how they described John Fawcett's congregation in Wainsgate. And after serving that poor, rural, backwards, illiterate congregation for a few years, John Fawcett received a call to a much more prestigious pulpit in London. It was the Carter's Lane Baptist Church, and Fawcett thought, finally, I can get out of here and go somewhere where they'll appreciate a man of my training and stature. So he said yes to Carter's Lane Baptist Church, but he couldn't go. He found himself, backwards as they were, loving the people of Waynesgate, and wound up staying there for 54 years. Now, here's where the story gets a little apocryphal, and we don't know exactly the details. Some writers have said that Fawcett had his wagon loaded up, and they were getting ready to leave for London, and his wife said, goes one of the stories, "We can't leave these dear people." And they unloaded the cart and decided to stay. Okay, that's not going to happen. But Fawcett was in the habit of writing hymns, as many pastors were in that day. And some have suggested that he wrote this hymn for this occasion, for his leaving Waynesgate. Others say no, that was part of his collection of hymns already written. But the hymn he wrote is one of the most classic, long-lasting hymns in our hymnals. It has been published in more than 2,100 hymnals. This farewell hymn that John Fawcett wrote, either on the occasion of his entertaining the offer to go to Carter's Lane in London, or perhaps at another time. But listen to the farewell hymn. Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Before our Father's throne, we pour our ardent prayers, our fears, our hopes, our aims are one, our comforts and our cares. We share our mutual woes, our mutual burdens bear, and often for each other flows the sympathizing tear. When we are sundered apart, it gives us inward pain. But we shall still be joined in heart. And hope to meet again. Until that meeting, be on your guard. 10,000 foes arise to stop you from doing and being what you know you need to do and be. I commend you to God, who's able to keep you and use you and bless you. So says the word of God. Let us pray. Holy One, Thank you for our colleague Paul and for the Ephesians and what they experienced as they worked together. And I thank you for this Crossroads family and what we have experienced as we have lived and worshiped and served together. Now we commit ourselves afresh to you and ask that you help us, for we do not know what to do without your guidance. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your bringing to our remembrance what Jesus, our Master, taught. May we be Christian thoroughly as we respond to forces both external and internal. May your word, your authoritative word, come out through us. May we stand for what is right. May we do your bidding. May we trust and obey. It is our prayer in the strong name of the one who came, that we might be brought to you, O God. We bless you. Amen. I want to read the end of this 20th chapter of Acts. I told you that, in my opinion, is one of the most emotional passages in the entire New Testament, and I deliberately didn't read the end of the chapter as we read the text. So now, brethren, verse 32, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I've coveted no one's silver or gold or apparel. Yes, you yourselves know that these hands have provided for my necessities and for those who are with me. I've shown you in every way by laboring like this that you must support the weak. And remember the words of Jesus, that he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And when he'd said these things, he knelt down and prayed with them all. And they all wept freely and fell on Paul's neck and kissed him, sorrowing most of all for the words which he spoke, that they would see his face no more. And they accompanied him to the ship. Amen. Some of you I will see no more. It's just what it is. Let us rejoice that we had this time together. Amen. If you're able, would you please stand for the closing hymn. As we sing this closing hymn, you might be here today and you say, Pastor Farmer, it's very clear that Paul had a relationship with God that informed all he did and said, and I'm not sure I've got that. I'd love to put you in touch with one of our counselors who will talk to you about how you could have this personal spiritual life that was so vibrant in Paul and in many of the Ephesians. Secondly, you might be here and you say, Pastor Farmer, I would love to be part of this Crossroads Church, an imperfect people in pursuit of a perfect God. If that describes you, when we start singing this closing hymn, you come. I'll be happy to connect you with, I see Diane Thornton, would you just stand with me here in the front this morning? Or do you have to get out immediately? You have to leave Are you able to serve as one of our counselors? And is Terrence here? Terrence is not here. You come as we sing. We'd be delighted to speak with you. Amen.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt upon earth by his temple is here. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming for glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on the tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Dying he justified, really forever. One day he's coming for glorious day. One day they left him the moment that mountain. One day they nailed him to die on the tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day is coming for glorious day. One day they left him alone in the garden. One day he rested from suffering free. Angels came down on his tomb to keep vigil. Hope of the hopeless, my Savior is he. Living he loved me, dying he saved me.
Buried,
buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming for glorious day. One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. And he arose over death he had conquered. Now he's ascended, my Lord evermore. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming for glorious day.
Would you please look up and receive the benediction with your eyes open? And now, beloved, I commend you to God, who is able to keep you and preserve you unto the end. May the Lord bless you and put steel in your spines, for the wolves are coming. Be on your guard. And may God use you to address inappropriate behavior and heresy and dissension and discord. May the love of Jesus the Christ ooze from your pores. May God be glorified. And may the saints, because of you, be edified. And may the wolves be terrified. Amen.